This is part two of our conversation with Zach Wilson, who is a data engineer at Airbnb. He has worked with Facebook and Netflix before and solved so many cool problems. He cracked interviews in these three big tech companies, so obviously he knows the art of cracking data engineering interviews, and that's what we're going to talk about today. We'll discuss a lot of useful interview tips for data engineer role that you'll find it useful. Let's get started. Zach is pretty active on LinkedIn with more than 100,000 followers, and I love reading his post about data engineering and mental health. So if you want to learn from him, please make sure you follow him on LinkedIn. He also started a YouTube channel recently. We are going to link all of those things in a video description below. I feel you are probably the best person to talk about interview tips because you have cracked interviews in Netflix, Facebook, and Airbnb, like top companies, right?
Yeah.
So first question, do companies like Netflix and Facebook require you to have a computer science degree in order for you to consider for a data engineering interview?
No, definitely not. Definitely not. Like that is... Like I've worked with a lot of people at Facebook who and at Netflix, both companies that like where they like they'll hire people who have different backgrounds for sure. Like it's more about like you're gonna need to have some sort of like relevant experience. Like if you don't have a computer science degree, like having relevant experience in data engineering is probably gonna be pretty critical. Like I think it's gonna be a little bit more challenging to like get into Facebook or Netflix or these companies like. If you have 0 years of experience and don't have like a computer science degree, you need something that's like relevant to the role that like will help you break into it, like a portfolio or like some other things like
that. Kaggle competition, Stack Overflow. Yeah. You know, some people I've seen.
Yeah.
I interviewed one person who was a mechanical engineer, but every day he would, you know, do some contribution on Kaggle and he built up a good rank. And based on that, he got a data job as a data scientist. So Kaggle, Stack Overflow, somewhere you should be contributing.
Yeah, definitely. That's a huge one, right? And then it's a little bit different at Netflix, right? Because they don't generally hire like junior engineers very much. So like they only really hire senior engineers. So like when I got hired at Netflix, I was like a senior data engineer. So like to work at Netflix specifically, you're going to need like several years of data engineering experience to like get into that job. But like, you still don't necessarily need a computer science degree.
And this is a theme I've seen, like after you have 2 to 3 years of experience, your degree doesn't matter. Now, someone is preparing for a data engineering career, let's say they learn all the skills that you talked about, right, from online resources. Let's say they go to your YouTube channel, learn data engineering, they read a bunch of books. Now, the most important thing on the resume is the projects. So what kind of, like, do you have any suggestions on the sample projects that one can have on the resume? And where can they get ideas of such projects and especially the data sets for these kind of projects?
For sure. I'll talk a little bit about my the project that I had on my resume to help me get into Facebook. So like I still am like really fascinated by the game Magic the Gathering, right? Which is like a card game, right? Where you can you have a deck and you battle another person who has a deck and then like one of you wins, right? And in that game, like I ended up building an app and like a database around that and like what I did was like I built an app that like got a bunch of people in on it, right? And then they loaded their decks into the app. And then with all of those decks, I used those decks as a training set to like build a recommender. So like if you looked at a card, it would recommend what other cards you should play with this card based on what decks they showed up together in.
Okay.
Right? And that was like, yeah. And that was like a project I worked on. Like, and obviously that was like a lot of work and a lot of effort and probably like more than like would be needed to break into these companies. Like I was just, but that was, this is like probably my biggest guidance on picking a project is you want to pick a project that you're passionate about. Right. And I, like, for me, I really liked Magic the Gathering. Right. And like the reason why I knew it was going to be a good data set is because there's like 50,000 unique cards. Right. So like, that's already a pretty, you know, pretty big bulky thing that you can look at and see like, oh yeah, this is a pretty big data set of. So like one of the things I recommend is like think about something that you care about that probably has a catalog of things, right? Like maybe you like books, maybe you like cards, maybe you like video games, maybe you like, you know, whatever, restaurants, like whatever, right? Mm-hmm. Then what you can do is you can build up that catalog of things, right? from the internet. Like, you might get lucky and there's just like some beautiful CSV file on the internet you can download. Probably not, but maybe, right? Yeah. And then if there isn't, there's probably a website, almost guarantee there's a website to get the catalog of things. And then to build up that catalog, what you can do is you build a scraper, right? And just scrape it from the internet. And then you have your data set, and then you can do your data engineer, data science-y stuff on it. And like, if you can show the scraper and you can show that, like, you're like, hey, I built this and there wasn't
even nice.
Data, there was no data set for it. That's even better than like saying, oh, hey, I downloaded the irises data set from Kaggle and I ran the, you know, the scikit learn on it, right? And just did the basic stuff, right? That's what everyone's done. Right.
Yeah. So, Titanic and Iris is like, you should not have that on your resume because everyone.
Yeah. It's like saying I printed Hello World on in Scala, so I'm proficient in it. Right. Yeah, for sure.
Cool. Yeah,
so I think that's a big one. Mm-hmm.
All right. So just to summarize what you said, like write some web scraper in Python, get the data, and then build a project around your passion. So the recommender that you built, was it using some type of machine learning or some heuristic based approach?
Just heuristic. I just graduated college and like I was just like, oh, I can. What I did was like I just counted the co-occurrences, right? So if it's like you have one, if you have two cards in a deck, or if you have two cards and you were comparing to see if they should be recommended, there's going to be some cards that show up together more often than other cards, and then you just do that, and then but then you have to filter, right? Because some cards are just extremely common, and you don't want to be like, oh yeah, you're always just recommending the super super common cards. Like then there's like a filter on the super super common cards, but then everything else is just around co-occurrences and counts, right? It was just like I think of it as like a fancy little self join and then a group buy, right? That's what it was to figure out that.
Nice. Awesome. Okay. So in these big tech companies, like what is the structure of data engineer interview? Is it like multiple rounds? I'm assuming it's multiple rounds, correct?
Yeah. So yeah.
You want to walk through that whole structure?
Yeah, for sure. So generally speaking, you're going to first get a code screen, right? And like that is going to be like a 45-minute code screen, like to just make sure that like you know how to code and that like, and usually that round is really easy. Like every time I go into that round, like especially now, and I still get those code screens, I'm like, yeah, that round is easy. That round is it's not that hard. Like they're going to give you like elite code easy or elite code medium question, generally speaking, in that, in that 45-minute interview. And then assuming that you pass that, then you go to the on-site interview. On-site interview is generally like at Facebook, it was 8 hours. Like it was eight rounds.
Wow.
And then at Netflix, it was different. At Netflix, it was two 4-hour rounds. It was still 8 hours, but it was broken across 2 days, which was way better. I like that way better. 2 4-hour rounds is way better than 1 8-hour round. Especially because like by the end of that 8-hour round, it was like, whoa. Yeah. But so generally there's going to be a round when you get into the interview process and everything, you're going to have a round on data modeling and then you'll get like a business problem, and then you'll need to define like the schemas and the tables and how you would solve that business problem it's vague on purpose, right? So that so that they can understand your data modeling expertise. That's a very important round.
Sometimes they judge, you know, what kind of intelligent counter questions you're asking.
Oh yeah, asking questions is so important. Like if
it's
you
so
aren't
important.
Asking questions, like yeah, if you're not asking questions at all and you're just like trying to like solve the problem and just quickly give me an answer, like that's generally a bad sign. People who do that strategy generally don't get hired. Right?
Yes.
And so that's a round. Another round is around like architecture, and like software architecture and distributed systems and stuff like that, and understanding like how like you like know like maybe the internals of Spark or the internals of like different databases, maybe like Cassandra or like Hive or whatever. Like it's another round that's very oriented around like more, it's more technical, right? And more technical focused and less data focused. That's like another kind of architecture round. Then there's going to be like a coding round. The coding round is and that coding round is going to be more involved, right? You're probably going to get like one. Usually it's like two like medium, like lead code medium questions. I've never gotten a LeetCode code hard question like ever as a data engineer, because like I don't think even software engineers generally get hard questions, because like that's just messed up. Like, it's very hard to answer that in 45 minutes on the spot, you know?
Yeah.
So there's like a, you know, coding round. That's another round. There's like a behavioral round. That's another like important round to talk about, just like, okay, like give me a time that you gave feedback. Give me a time that you did this or that. Right. And that, like, you kind of talk about like how you would behave in certain circumstances. And then there's another round around, like projects, right? Talking about a project deep dive, right? And that, like, what's a project you worked on in the past that like you delivered value in, or, you know, things like that. That's like a, there's that round. And then there's a round on like SQL. I think that, yeah, that's all the rounds. It's like five or six, right? It's, yeah. I don't know. That was like 5 years ago though. So like, like Facebook might've changed by now, but like, that's how it was when I interviewed back then.
Cool. And I think you already discussed a little bit about data structures and algorithm, but you want to discuss that piece one more time, like
for sure. So like a couple things about and I'm kind of talk more about coding interview guidance. I think that's more than just like these are the things you should learn. A couple things about coding interviews. Like, one is that, like, remember that you are interviewing with someone, right? And that, like, that person is there to work with you on stuff, right? And like, if you get a hint or two, you're not gonna, that doesn't mean like you're not gonna, you don't lose, right? So like, if you're stuck in a point, start asking questions, trying to clarify things, start to try to work around the problem and understand like what you need to do differently and like what is like why you're stuck, right? And like communicate, right? Because like they're looking for more than like just did you solve the problem. It was like, did you solve the problem? Do they communicate well? Like, how, what do they do when like they get stuck on a problem? Like, all these different things are important to also consider, right? When you're like interviewing for a role, it's not just like, okay, I solved my two LeetCode mediums, therefore I got the job. It's not like that easy, right? It's not like that, right? And so, yeah, I think that's a big thing. Another thing to remember is to just like breathe and don't put too much pressure on yourself. Like, I've also been on the other side, right, where I've been the interviewer a lot, right? And a lot of times I can tell there's a lot of people who are in those situations that they put way too much pressure on themselves to like do those problems, and then it causes them so much anxiety and then they can't think. And that's like being more, you know, entering with a more relaxed mindset, being more like mindful about like how your thoughts are processing and like how you're pressuring yourself maybe, and being aware of these things, like it can help you just be in a better state emotionally to answer the questions.
And you know, if you're nervous or something, like you're leaving a bad sign that when you join that company and if you are working under a very high pressure project, you will behave the same way. So it's better to keep your calm. You know, the more calmer you are, it's gonna help you. Now, are there like few, so LeetCode competitive coding questions are okay, but other than that, in terms of design questions and data modeling question, do you have one or two specific question in mind that you want to discuss?
Yeah, sure. Let's talk about something like that. So like, for example, like there was like a data modeling question, right? So say we like needed to, like, so at Facebook, a big one was around like the friend graph, right? And understanding like, okay, how would you model, like, okay, so if you have this data set of like, this person sent this friend request to this person, right? And then another row later says like, okay, this person accepted or declined and stuff like that, right? And so that's the like upstream data set, right? And then a big thing that it tries to do then is like, okay, determine like the right data model to take from taking that like raw data into seeing like, okay, how many friends does each user have, right? Mm-hmm. That's a big thing, right? And being able to ask questions like, how many friends does each user have? And kind of understanding like, okay, what about like other dimensions, right? Like what country is accepting the most friend requests? What country has the best accept rate, right? And asking questions around those are kind of like the setting, right? That's the setup for the question, right? And then understanding like, okay, we can take this and then we can build like a dimension table at like the user level, right? And we can say like, okay, this user sent this many requests, accepted this many requests, and declined this many requests, right? And then there's like that dimension table that you that you want to figure out, right? And then you understanding that dimension table and then how to aggregate it to build like an aggregation table that can explain like more of the like the country level things, right? And the other dimensions that like are a little bit higher level than like a user level, right? And so being able to go through that process is like very important, right? And I think that that is that's kind of like the high level way of like doing data modeling for sure. That's like and coming up, understanding like how to get to your dimension tables, your fact tables, and your ag tables. That part is critical, and that's what they're really looking for there, is being able to do that.
Perfect. All right, now the last question. There is a website called levels.fyi where you can go and get some idea about the salaries of data engineers, but what are your thoughts, like in terms of junior and senior data engineer, like how much on average they make in this big companies?
In the big companies? That's a good one. I mean, so generally, like, I think it's important to differentiate like salary and total compensation, but like, so like total compensation wise, like a junior data engineer, is going to make like probably like 250 to 300 K, like 250, 300 K, somewhere in that range. Just, and then, a senior engineer is probably going to be closer to like 400, like 350, 400, like, total comp. All right. Which is, it depends on the company too, right? Cause like some companies like Netflix, for example, like their compensation is very different from Airbnb and Facebook. Airbnb and Facebook's compensation like structure is very, very similar. And then Netflix is very different, right? Whereas at Netflix, right, they just pay all cash, right? And they like, they also say that, oh, we're going to pay you what's called your top of personal market, which is like the most, essentially they're like, we'll pay you the most money that you can find in the market, right? That's like what their philosophy is, right? And and so that's it's pretty interesting how that like kind of works out, right? So senior engineers at Netflix make a lot more money, right? So I think at Netflix, like it's like 500K is like, and it's all cash. It's 500K salary, right? Not like there's no like there's not like very much of like a stock element in their compensation package. Whereas at Facebook and Airbnb, the stock element is pretty significant. So
the Netflix basically is predictable. You're just making 500, you're making 500. But if you're working in Facebook or Airbnb, and if the stock prices shoot up, you were promised 400, but you might end up making 600.
Yep. Or the other way around too. It can cut more ways, right? Yeah.
Well, the way Fed has been printing money since last few years, I don't think it will go the other way around.
Yeah.
I just feel like stock market just keeps on going up, you know?
It does. It's weird.
And by the way, we have a lot of international viewers watching this video. So whatever numbers we discuss are in US dollars. So when we said 300 and 400, those are like 400,000 US dollar per year. Mm-hmm. All right, Zach, it was an amazing conversation. I feel like I myself learned a lot of things, and our viewers are also going to learn a lot of useful tips, especially the interview tips. And we are going to provide a link of Zach's awesome LinkedIn and YouTube channels links in the video description below. So make sure you follow him. I think he has great plans for coming year. And Zach, thank you very much for having this conversation.
For sure. This has been awesome. Thank you for having me on the show.
Thank you. Bye.